Very good evening to all. Fairly audible and visible. So this is the second episode for your upcoming INICET exams in particular. We'll be revising some important topics and the topics which you told in the last session to revise, like torture techniques and all. So before starting the session, a quick briefing about the R-Academy NEET PG Plus segment. With every Plus subscription, you get access to both live and recorded classes. Even if you miss the live session, you can watch the recordings which are available. Then you can study on the device of your choice. Then you can take benefits of Iconic subscription, which is a combination of Unacademy and Prep Ladder segment. And now a new feature has been introduced, that is raise a hand, where you can directly communicate with the faculties during live sessions to clarify any of your doubts. Very good evening to all. Then the number of questions in the question bank of Unacademy NEET PG segment is now more than 25,000. And these are the NEET PG toppers who utilized Unacademy segment. And these are the NEET PG and NEXT free tests. These are basically subject wise tests which are going to be held for your upcoming NEET PG exams and NEXT pattern exams. And you can go through this. Everything is available on Unacademy website. And there is an upcoming combat quiz session also on 28th of November. These are the batch courses which have started for Plus courses, in Plus courses, targeting your FMG 2022 exams. That is a 6-month batch course which is going to start on 17th of November. And there is a FMG free test also on 13th of November for your upcoming FMG exams. Then you can use this code VishuLife for any Unacademy subscription or to watch any special classes. Then these are NEET PG batch courses targeting your next year NEET PG exams and next to next year NEXT pattern exams. These batch courses are also starting on 17th of. And now this is the final checkout page where you can select your Plus segment only or the Iconic subscription and you can go ahead. So we are good to go. So let us start with our session. And this is the first question for today. Put in your answers. A woman delivered fetuses of different age. She alleges a male to be their father. It was denied by the father. On paternity testing, he was found to be the father of one of the kids. This is suggestive of which of the following? This is suggestive of which of? The correct answer here goes with? Correct answer goes with superfetation. Correct answer goes with superfetation. Because this is one condition which is humanly not possible, but you can get it as a theoretical question. You all know that superfetation is act of coitus, different act of coitus in different menstrual cycle. That is why the age of the fetus can become different in superfetation. But in fecundation, what happens? Act of coitus in same menstrual cycle, so the age of the fetus remains same. But there, in both the situations, what is different? Act of coitus. Act of coitus is different. But this event is occurring in same menstrual cycle. This is occurring in different menstrual cycle. That is why the age of the fetus differs. And so the answer of choice will go with superfetation. Don't mark superfecundation for such a question. A similar question came in your NEET PG 2021 exams. There the answer was superfecundation because what was given in the question was a woman delivered twins. Examiner wanted to tell you that the fetuses are of same age. They particularly mentioned this thing. Answer goes with superfetation. What is a posthumous child? You all know. At the birth of the child, the father is already dead. Such a child is called posthumous child. And supposititious child is a fictitious child brought forward by a female. Brought forward by a female alleging that so and so male is the father, while actually it is not so. There is a motive to get the marriage done with the male or to get some money from the male. So that is a false child, fictitious child, or supposititious child. I hope you all remember the tabulated format in which we have covered this topic, superfecundation, fetation, and twins. If not, now we will cover it in the last part of the today's session. Now, do a match the following, and these are your four options, A, B, C, D. Put in the correct answers. These are your four options. This is the proper INICT pattern questions. Put in your answers. So the matching is parallel. Stage one of iron toxicity. This is basically acute iron toxicity, which has been divided into four stages, not four, in total five stages. Stage one is GIT stage, which lasts for first 6 hours. A goes with one. Stage two is latent recovery stage for next 6 to 24 hours. Person might recover. The patient might recover. If given the antidote, that is desferrioxamine, within time. Then comes a stage 3 for next 24 to 48 hours. Now the patient can present to you with metabolic and CVS, CNS, multiple system involvement, complications. Then stage 4 is the liver involvement, that is hepatic stage. For next 2 to 4 days, the patient will go in a hepatic stage where very prominent feature of jaundice can be seen in the patient. And stage 5 is the delayed stage, which can run for several weeks. That is a delayed stage, stage 5. That can run for weeks, and here the GI complications can occur. Because iron leads to, always remember, this is corrosive for GIT. Acts as a corrosive for our gastrointestinal tract. So delayed complications will be like strictures. Strictures means fibrous bands in your GIT lumen. Then this can give rise to intestinal obstruction also. Subacute is intestinal obstruction, SAIO. Actually, these are the complications in delayed stage. Yes, A1, B2, C3, D4. Option A is the correct answer. This was a recent question of July month. Don't miss this question. Next one. What should be the best answer to this one? This topic was requested by you all in the last session. We'll be covering this complete topic. At least all the methods. We will do a quick revision. The correct answer goes with, a person in police custody was placed in prone position with his wrist and ankles bound behind his back. Something like this. Wrist and ankles bound behind his back. Bound means they were tied. And they were secured by a cord. What is this method called? This method is called the correct answer goes with hog tying. And this is what hog tying is. Person is in a prone position, and now his hand and feet are tied with a rope or a cord. This is a method of torture called hog tying. What is falanga? Falanga is this. Beating over souls. This goes with falanga. And what were the other two options in the same exam question? Other two options were carotid sleeper hold and in choke hold. Let us see them with the help of an image. This image number one goes with carotid sleeper hold. Type of torture. This is another type of torture called in choke hold. And you can very well appreciate that, yes, here the cubital fossa is in the midline of neck. The lateral side of the neck will be compressed. The front of the neck will also be compressed. And the lateral side, we have our internal carotids. both the internal carotids will be compressed, and that is why it is called carotid sleeper hold. Now, what is this? Now, the forearm is placed in a horizontal position, and usually the pressure is only over midline. Now, airways compression will be there. Some compression of carotids can occur still here, based on the position of the victim, based on the position of the accused. But mainly the airways will be compressed in choke hold. That is why the term used is this word. That means airways will be compromised maximally. Now, what is mugging? Mugging is a sort of carotid sleeper hold only. Mugging is compression of neck by broad object. And medically, broad object has been classified to bend of elbow, an area as shown in the image that goes with carotid sleeper hold. But other things, other areas which can be used for mugging is bend of knee joint, then your sole of foot, compressing your airways. That is, mugging is a broad term. Carotid sleeper hold is mugging by bend of elbow, sort of. Mugging is a broad term where compression can be done by bend of knee joint, sole of foot also. While carotid sleeper hold is like this only. Understood now the difference? So this is phalanga. So these are our different types of tortures. Let us do a quick recap. Like if you get a question like what is the most common method of torture overall? Answer goes with beating. Beating is the most common method of torture overall. Beating over soles is called phalanga. Another name used is bastinado. Then beating over ears, use telephone over ears. This method is called telefona. Other methods of beating are chepuava and el quirofano. Very unique names. Then another technique of torture is suspension technique. If the person is suspended by wrist, this is referred to as la bandera. If the person is suspended by feet, this is el murciélago. If the both the hand and feet are tied, this is called parrot's purse. If I show you an image and I ask you, what is this? Answer goes with, yes, this is la bandera. Suspension of the person has been done with his wrist. Now the suspension is over feet area. This goes with, yes, el murciélago. And this one goes with, yes, hand and feet both are tied. So parrot's purse. You can answer either if the question comes in an image-based manner or a direct question. You'll be in a position to answer any such question. These are the two techniques which are mostly used. Beating techniques, suspension techniques. Other technique which is commonly used is near suffocation techniques, where the person is suffocated so that he utters, confesses even a false thing. These are torture techniques. So dry submarino and wet submarino are near suffocation techniques. In dry submarino, what is done? A nylon bag is taken and the person's airways, this till neck region, the nylon bag is tied so that he is not able to take the fresh oxygen. So the nylon bag will be filled with lots of CO2 over a period of time. And now the person will get suffocation feeling. So this is a method of torture called dry submarino. What is wet submarino? Submersing the airways, that is mouth and nose, inside water. This is wet submarine. Both are near suffocation techniques of torture. Then other methods of techniques of torture are forced posture techniques as well as thermal techniques. These are the ones which are usually most common is beating method of torture. Then remember that hog tying, carotid sleeper hold, in choke hold. These are our different methods of torture. This is what you need to remember. That's it. Now, what will be the answer to this one? What is preserved in death due to excess inhalational anesthetic agent and the person has died? What you will preserve during autopsy? In Chepuava, people tie bamboos around the lower limbs and then that beating is done. In Chepuava, no, this is a beating technique. So bamboos are tied to the limbs and then beating is done. Best answer to this question will be intact lung in Nalan bag. But because this is not given in the option, intact lung in Nalan bag. So next best answer goes with mesenteric fats. Because inhalational anesthetic agents, they have a tendency to get concentrated in mesenteric fats. Now do a match the following. Like image number one is going to be matched with which one? These are your five options. Then match this image number two. Who are matching yourself? And image number three. We have image number four. Image number 5 is not visible, so I will tell you. Image number 5 is basically image of your coronographic pulse. 5 goes here. Take a 5 goes here. Joule burn is image number 2. Right? Arsenic poisoning is image number 1. Raindrop pigmentation and hyperkeratosis changes. Crocodile burns goes with image number 4. And marbling goes with, yes, image number 3. Correct. Nicely done by Sada. Let us move ahead. Identify the fingerprint pattern shown in the image quickly. The moment you see plain ridges going, so it becomes arch. Because there is no core, either core nor delta. That makes the print as, what is absent is? Absent core and delta. They are used to identify the finger. This is basically a plain arc. Very good. This is basically a plain arc. Arches can be plain or tented. Tented arc will be something like a tent house. You will see the ridges going and making a tent house, moving away. They will not converge on itself. They will go away. Sort of tent house, if it is formed here, that becomes tented arc. Okay. This one is plain arc. Answer this one. Under what circumstances dying declaration given by a person of sound mind becomes invalid? Details of this we have covered in our classes. Tubes, whorls, arches, composite, how to get them identified. Correct answer here goes with yes. If the victim survives after recording dying declaration, then the victim will be called to courts, come to court and record your oral evidence. Which has a higher weightage out of oral evidence and documentary evidence? Which has a higher weightage? Oral evidence given by a person or documentary evidence? Answer goes with oral, because in oral evidencing what can be done? Cross-examination of the witness can be done. So under what circumstances dying declaration given by a person of sound mind becomes invalid or inadmissible in courtroom? Even if the dying declaration is half recorded, it is admissible. Even if it is not signed by the dying person, it is admissible. And dying declaration can be recorded by any person, best if recorded by a magistrate. If not available, by a doctor or by any person who is with the person who is going to die. If I ask you, dying declaration is which type of evidence? Oral evidence or documentary evidence? What will be your answer? Dying declaration improper is which type of evidence? Oral or documentary? Answer to mark will be? Dying declaration Bank declaration is a statement recorded by a person, written by a person. That written is a document. Bank declaration is a documentary evidence. Always remember. And this is one of the exceptions of oral evidence in our courtroom procedure. Answer this one. Simple question. Do a quick recap of these tests. With regards to fetal death classification, lung is dipped in water in which of the following tests? With regards to fetal death, lung is dipped in water in which of the following test? Yes, the answer goes with hydrostatic test, also called as Regatt's test, or flotation test, also called as Regatt's test or flotation. What is the principle used in Regatt's test? Specific gravity of lungs taken into account. What is taken into account in Fordry's test? Weight of lungs. Weight of both lungs. Both lungs. What is taken into account in Plockett's test? Weight of both lungs in numerator. And this is divided by weight of the fetus itself. Divided by weight of fetus itself. What is Redden's test? Here we look for presence of air in middle ear. Air in middle ear. And one more test is there. Breslau's second life test. Also called as stomach bowel test. So Breslau's second life test. What we look for in this test is presence of air in stomach and bowel. Air in stomach and bowel. So these are your five tests to distinguish stillbirth from live birth. Okay, no? Answer to this one, sexual gratification through obscene telephone calls. Yes. Sexual gratification, obscene telephone calls. Yes. The correct answer goes with scatologica. For this word, scatologica goes with telephone calls. Obscene telephone calls. Whereas option A, option B, and option D, they are same things. Act of voyeurism, punishable under which IPC section? Voyeurism is a punishable offense under which IPC? I will give you the hint. It's 354, but which alphabet, which subsection? 354 makes voyeurism a punishable offense. What is voyeurism? Watching or capturing private movements of a female secretly. Answer this one. Microscopic crystals as shown in the image is seen in which test? Microscopic crystal as shown is seen in which of the answer goes with pink feathery crystals. The color is pink. Even if you're not able to recall the feathery shape, the color is pink. And pink color crystals are seen only in Takayama test. Hickman shows you brown rhombic crystals. Florin shows you brown rhombic crystals. Barberio shows you yellow needle shaped crystals. What is the difference between Hickman's and Florin's? The difference is in sample itself and the reagent. In Hickman's, the sample is a red stain sample. In Florin's, the sample will be a white stain sample. These are four microscopic tests which are asked repeatedly, so do revise this topic. If you are not confident of this topic, then this is another area which is explored in our exams. Rotten egg odor is associated with. They can give you a match the following poisons with their odors. Can very well come as a match the following question. So rotten egg odor is associated with. The correct answer goes with egg. Egg goes with H2S, hydrogen sulfide. The correct answer. Aluminium phosphide and zinc phosphide. Aluminium phosphide and zinc phosphide. What is the odor of these poisons? This is also repeatedly asked. Rotten fish odor. Or we say musty fishy odor. Musty fishy or rotten fishy odor. Arsenic has which odor? Garlicky. What is the odor of phosphorus? Again garlicky. These are the tables which needs to be revised. Odor tables, postmortem staining tables should be revised, for example. Then urine sample during autopsy is preserved in. Best answer. Urine sample during autopsy will be preserved in which preservative? Again, a hot topic. Visceral preservation and preservative. Who revised this topic? Answer goes with thymol and thymol. Thymol is the best answer. But urine sample during autopsy is preserved. Urine sample during autopsy in a case of alcoholic poisoning. What is the preservative used? Here we don't use thymol. Alcoholic poisoning, what we prefer is, what is the preservative? Answer is phenyl mercuric nitrate. Phenyl mercuric nitrate, PMN. Phenyl mercuric nitrate. Preserve the urine sample in a case of alcoholic poisoning. Preservative used is phenyl mercuric. Now, let us do a quick recap of that table of superfecundation. Superfetation and twins. If I ask you, what about menstrual cycle? Which event occur in one menstrual cycle? Yes, the answer goes with twins. Answer goes with superfecundation. Whereas in fetation, it is different. Menstrual cycle is totally different, which is not possible actually in humans. Here the menstrual cycle is different. Now, if I ask you, what about act of coitus? Act of coitus. Act of coitus has to be single in twins. But act of coitus is always different in fecundation and fetation. That is how they are different from twins. Otherwise, fecundation and twins will be same thing. This is how they are different. If the act of coitus is different, what about fathers? Fathers can be same or can be different. Fathers has to be, wherever the act of coitus is single, the father has to be same or both the twins. But what about fecundation? Because the act of coitus is different, fathers can be same or different. I can say yes, fathers can be different here. And here also the act of coitus is different. Fathers can be different here also. That was the question. Now, the most important thing is age of the fetus. In twins and fecundation, what occurs is the event occurs in same menstrual cycle. So, the age of the fetus will almost be same. Whereas in fetation, what is happening? The fertilization is occurring in another menstrual cycle. That is why the age of the fetus has to be different. It cannot be same. I hope it is clear now. Remember these conditions of multiple pregnancy under these four criteria, and you will never mark any question from this area wrong. Always remember this in this tabulated form. Any other queries which you are having or any particular topic which you want to revise, do let me know. You can tell me right now or do let me know in my Telegram group. And tomorrow also the session is at same time. 9:30 to 10 p.m. One day before your exam. Any particular topic which you want to cover up, do let me know so that I can plan accordingly for tomorrow's session. Difference between anterior and middle cranial fossa fracture. Those things are now anterior cranial fossa fracture. There is fracture of anterior cranial fossa. What is the related question which can be asked from this area is, you can get ectopic bruising, around eyes. That is called black eye, panda eye or raccoon eye. If there is fracture of middle cranial fossa, what additional finding you can get in the patient is ectopic bruising over mastoid, and that is called as Battle sign. called as Battle Snakes. I will try to keep it tomorrow. Alcohol toxicity also I will keep it. 75 and 376 IPC. We can revise these IPCs right now. Let us simplify this sense of rape. Rape is defined in which section? It is defined in 375. All of you know. And then there are certain sections of punishments, like punishment for rape offense in particular comes under 376 subsection 1 of the IPC section. What is the minimum punishment? You should remember 10 years. Earlier it was 7 years. Maximum is life imprisonment. Then comes 376 subsection 2. 376 subsection 2 says that yes, a new word has been added, custodial rape. There are many other situations like offense of rape with a pregnant female, then offense during this rape offense during communal violence, sectarian violence, or when it is done by relatives or by person in authority. That is covered under 376 subsection 2. Punishment is same, 10 to life imprisonment. What else you should remember is all the new additions which have been added in 2019. So the new sections which have been added in 2019 is 376 subsection 3, which deals with the punishment for rape offense with female less than 16-year-old. Then comes 376 subsection AB. This deals with the same offense when committed with a female less than 12 years old. Then comes 376DA deals with the offense of gang rape with a female less than 16 year old, and 376DB deals with offense of gang rape with a female less than 12 years old. These are the new sections which were added in 2019. Please remember these new sections. Any other queries which you are having? Alcohol toxicity, I will try to keep it tomorrow. Any other particular topic which you want to revise, do let me know. For vitriol age, we have those sections now. 26 A and B. Grievous hurt either by throwing acid, or grievous hurt caused either by administering acid. That is a punishable offense under 326 A. And 326 B says even attempt. An attempt to throw acid is a punishable offense. Attempt to throw acid. These are two special sections which were made in 2013 cover the act of vitriolage. Male-female pelvis, just remember one basic line. In females, all parameters are large and wide. In pelvis, we are talking about the pelvis bone, except there are three exceptions. What is the mnemonic? Anyone? The mnemonic is OSA. OSA stands for O for obturator foramen, S for sacroiliac articulation surface, A for size of acetabulum. While all other parameters in females will be large and wide. And remember one more thing. In females, there are three things which are round. Males have a round forehead. Females have got a round orbit, and females have got a round chin. This is for female. in particular. Got it? I have blocked the messages. Someone was sending the types of messages. So any other queries? Any other queries? So tomorrow I will try to revise your toxicology, major chunk of toxicology, with the help of MCQs and with the help of images. Nature of gunshot wound in scalp. See, whenever the weapon is in contact, whether it is a rifled weapon or a shotgun weapon, what happens is, this is your scalp, suppose. Okay. Inside your scalp, you have your skull bone. This is the skull bone. And this is the scalp. The scalp has five layers, na? Skin, connective tissue, aponeurosis, loose areolar tissue. Okay. These are the layers. Now, suppose the weapon was in contact with the scalp. This is your query, na? Now, what will happen? Supposing this to be a rifled weapon, a bullet will come out. Along with the bullet, lots of discharges will come in the form of flame, smoke particles, and unburnt gunpowder particles. Now, this skull is a bony structure. It will produce some resistance that I will not allow this bullet to pass through me and all these effects. So, due to this resistance, there is a blowback phenomena. And due to this blowback phenomena, what occurs is you get a star shape entry wound, also called as stellate shape entry wound. Mainly in those areas where bone is just beneath the skin. Got it? Okay then, bye-bye. Time to end the session. I hope it is clear. Where was that? Ajit. The entry wound will become a star shape due to this blowback phenomenon. This phenomenon is called blowback phenomenon. Mainly seen in contact shots where the contact is over scalp area because the skull bone is just beneath the scalp. Beveling is a term used to define chipping of the skull bone, chipping of the skull table. Like to understand beveling, na? Let me cover this one. My skull bone, all of us have got thick skull bone, and the skull bone has got two important tables, outer table and inner table, because the skull bone is thick. It is thick. So if I fire a weapon from this side, and supposing this to be a rifled weapon, a bullet which is spinning will come out. Rifled weapon, inside the barrel they have lands and grooves. What is the purpose of lands? They give a spinning motion to the bullet. The bullet is moving forward and it is spinning also. When this spinning bullet hits the outer table, a sort of drill effect will be there, no? So that drill will make a clean hole in the outer table. But when it is going to, because this outer table is getting supported by the inner table. Now when this drilling effect is going to occur over inner table, now inside inner table what is present? Inside inner table you have your soft brain. Brain won't be able to support a bony structure. This drilling effect or spinning effect will take away some part of the inner table. Why? Because unsupported table shows beveling. In case of entry, which is the table which is unsupported? The inner table. Unsupported table remains inner table in entry. So that will show you beveling. Now when this bullet is coming out, again the same spinning motion will produce a clean hole in the inner table. Why? Because now the inner table is supported in the direction of motion of the bullet. And now when this spinned bullet is coming out, it will take away a part of the outer table, because outside outer table nothing is present. Outer table is unsupported in exit wound. Inner table is unsupported in entry. So the unsupported table shows beveling. In entry, the inner table is unsupported. So it shows beveling. Understood? Ajit? Remember this basic thing. Unsupported skull table shows beveling. Don't mug it that in entry beveling is over inner table. You will mark your answer wrong. So then let us meet tomorrow for the final session. All my best wishes to all of you. In nutshell, see, if I fire a weapon from this side, if I fire a firearm weapon, my kid's boy, if I fire this weapon from this side, I have my outer table. So from the outer table, the bullet is going to hit the outer table, and the outer table is getting supported by inner table. Now the inner table, inside the inner table, we have the brain matter. Brain is not going to support a bony structure, so inner table remains unsupported. Now when this bullet is coming out in that direction, inner table has the support of outer table, but outer table remains unsupported. The bullet takes away a part of the outer table. Tomorrow I will show you the images of bevel. That will make things more clear. Okay then, bye-bye.